Okay.
All right, guys, we're gonna get started. If you haven't signed the code already, it's okay. We're going to put it back up at the end. Right?
Yeah.
All right, so, welcome back to Ops. We're both very excited to see the amount of you here, actually. When you're caught here, it's gonna be fun for you guys. You're starting off on all these new tracks, and then, classes.
Mm-hmm.
And this is lecture 4.
Great.
All right, so we actually took into account a lot of your follow-up and feedback. So some of the tips and suggestions that you gave us, if you have some more hails that you'd like to share with us, please click it in the slides. But thank you for filling it out. One of the things that we got was that it was difficult to contact us, and we wanted to make sure that you guys knew our Discord usernames. They're on the board. Our lab hours are also there on the site, but you can also ask Sparky that. Just go to like the lab hours chat, you'll see the like reminder code to do it. It's really easy. And then if you ever need to email us, it's literally just ops@ieeebruins.com. I check my email a lot. I also check my Discord a lot now. And I know we always check Discord, but we're both very prominent on this, so yeah. And then hopefully our mic quality will be better. If we continue to use this room, don't worry, it will definitely be better. You'll be able to hear us better. And we're going to add more examples and walkthroughs to these slides to make it better for you guys as well.
Okay, in terms of winter quarter things, so Ops A is now Thursday, as you all probably know. There's a caveat to that, though. We figured out that apparently CS31 is also scheduled in this exact time slot, which is kind of a problem because I know quite a few people are in that class. So one of the questions on the check-in form was if you guys would be available on Wednesday at 6 p.m. We wouldn't like reschedule everything to Wednesday, but just in case, like, we could move a couple of events to Wednesday if that works better for people too. Make sure to check out the Ops Master Sheet because we are beginning to update things there again. I don't think we posted it yet, but we're going to have a lecture next week, same time, same place as well. We will also update that soon. Major like point you should know is that a lot of content is happening this quarter. We have like the most lectures, the most projects. We also have competitions, which are super fun. But we basically have like an event every single week. So please just make sure to check the master sheet. Make sure to keep your Discord notifications on because we're going to be like sending out a lot of information. And make sure to brush up on your CS skills because we're going to be doing a lot of that now. Or you can come to our workshops too, which is happening in 2 weeks. Wink, nudge, if you want to get an edge up for our next project, which we will announce soon.
All right. Also, Isha or IPP is telling us to talk to you about the InterGB Olympics. So if you guys are in a GB, we have the InterGB Olympics. I see someone in my GB here right now. I have actually no idea what the, I don't know what that is. I have no idea what the GB Olympics entails, but I assume it'll be fun. It'll probably be free day. So, for those of you in a GB, Sean.
Okay.
Alright, so we're going to begin lecture 4, all about Arduino. Arduino, I will be covering the Arduino basics, and then Miriam will be covering coding in Arduino, which is C++, alright? Alright, so we're going to begin with what is a microcontroller. A microcontroller is basically a programmable integrated circuit. It's used in a lot of modern applications. It's not to be confused with an FPGA, which is more logic-based. This is program-based, so you can program in Python, C++. It depends on the type you're using. But in terms of Arduino, it uses C, C++, well, it uses IDE, but that's based in C, C++. They have a lot of processors, they have memory, and they have general purpose input and output techniques, all in one. So it has a lot of potential, it has a lot that you can screw up and make do. So it's a lot of programming based, but don't worry. Arduino isn't hard to learn, it's pretty easy to use. And actually, I went to Rising Stars IEEE conference last week, and I was talking with a microchip recruiter, and he was talking about a lot of things that people don't have or projects on the resume. And he was talking about his own projects with Arduino and how it's very useful to use that. So from the stance of a recruiter when you do jobs, where not only is ops help you get some of those jobs with some good projects right now, but definitely if you enhance your skills in Arduino, you'll have a good project to be able to provide to a recruiter in the future if you're looking for an internship or a future job. And then there's a lot of microprocessors, microcontrollers. So they're great, and they just like a lot of different applications, Raspberry Pis, etc. So it depends on choosing the right one for your project, what they have. All right, so for ops, we're actually going to be using the Arduino Uno. It's pretty easy to use for beginners. It has a 5-volt operating voltage. It has an 18-mega 328P chip. That doesn't really matter for you guys to know. But you do need to know that it has 20 input output pins. Those are really useful because we can not only create waveforms to send out or take in information, we can do many such things with 20 pins. In addition, it's included with your kit, so that's a benefit. And because Arduino is an open source environment, that means that the community constantly updates and integrates ideas from feedback that is given to done throughout the years. This Arduino Uno that you're using is actually the third revolution or version of it. So they're using it. They've already updated it 3 times. It's the most current up-to-date one. There'll probably be a 4th one eventually. But Arduino is very much applicable to us right now. And it's very easy to learn. Alright, so one of the major things that you need to know in the community of electrical engineering or in the industry is learning how to read a pinout. Because the pinout diagram, which is right here, it teaches you all of the pins that are necessary and what they do. For example, right here is your ground pins, right here's your 3.3 volt pin and your 5 volt pin. We also have our various digital, PWM, and our analog. Alright, so all of these things teach you, the pinout sheet will help you learn how to operate your microcontroller, not just the Arduino, but for us, it'll help you with the Arduino. A symbolizes analog, D symbolizes digital. There's a little tilde sign that means it's a PWM pin. I'll tell you about that in like the next slide. And then in terms of all the other pins, we'll get to that, trust us. Basically, the pinout will help you with everything. Always refer to documentation, please. Except for like the one LED thing that we had a problem with because that documentation was wrong. We're sorry about that. But in general, the documentation is right, and it's always best to refer to that because then you can just plug on the documentation. Then you don't have to plug it on yourself, right? Okay, so there are 3 different pin types. There's digital, there's PWM, and there's analog, I referenced this earlier. So your digital pins can send and receive signals, but it works in binary. So in that case, it's a constant 0 or 1. You can output or input that information. In terms of inputting on a digital pin, it's kind of weird. We don't really use that too much, but it is applicable. In that case, I believe there's a range. It's like, let's say you're using a 5-volt reference. It's around 75% up. That voltage will be considered a 1, and everything else will be swiped down to a 0. That's something to look at the data sheet. I don't know that based on just the top of my head for this Arduino, but it depends on my controller as well. In terms of PWM, though, that's pulse with modulation. So in that case, we can actually simulate an analog wave with digital pins by varying the duty cycle and the orientation, or like the voltage, the peak voltage. And that's identifiable with the tilde symbol right here. And this is actually really useful because, as you know, computers don't work in analog. Your computers work as zeros and ones. And so by making variations of zeros and ones, we can simulate real-world applications. This is actually, the way that kind of works is if you have like a 5-volt amplitude of a wave and you do like a 50% duty cycle, what you're gonna end up getting is around 2.5 volts, right? As an average over time. And so it kind of works by averaging every interval on the clock. In this case, they constructively interfere, and then down here they destructively interfere. So you get a waveform that's starting to go downward as well. This mic's kind of trash. As for analog, that's input. So the real world, it works in analog. You don't see zeros and ones, you see colors, you see things moving, you see depth. A lot of things happen in our world, which is the analog signal world, right? But somehow we have to get that into the digital world because, you know, your fingerprint that opens your computer, or maybe you have Face ID on your computer or something like that. All that needs to be interpreted into a digital thing for your computer to understand. And that's what we work with when we input analog signals. We can't output analog signals unless we use VW. All right, and then I'm just gonna give a brief overview of Arduino IDE. This is the IDE platform. Right here we have void setup, void loop. Basically, the void setup function runs once, so it's what initiates basically pre the code starts. Obviously it doesn't happen like pre, you have to press the button and it goes, but in terms of setup, we like set our monitors, we declare our pinouts here generally so that we can ensure that we don't redeclare every single time in this. And in Arduino, I know a lot of you have dealt with loops before, maybe for a while loops in CS31. A void loop is where your main code runs repeatedly. And basically, every time the Arduino gets to the end of that code block, just reruns it over and over again until you to stop, unplug it, etc. Okay, in terms of compilation, you click the check, and that verifies your code. Basically, when you click that, make sure that you didn't you didn't mess up really badly, you know? Like, let's say I forgot a semicolon, right? Because we said it works mainly in C and C++, right? If you forget a semicolon, it's a big, all of a sudden your computer doesn't know what to do anymore, right? So in this case, this makes sure that you don't have any, like, basic computational errors. It doesn't find your logic errors for you, unfortunately. You have to find that on your own. As for scene, that magnifying glass in the corner is how you open your serial monitor. That's the way we get to view. Let's say we're putting an analog signal on an Arduino. That's the way we get to view it. We can output it to our serial monitor, which works at a 9600 baud rate. You'll learn that in time, but that's basically what we just always set it to. We'll explain that in this next project, so don't worry. But that's how you view it. That's how you can also view data. You can also just print your data form there. And then if you're about to take any of the physics labs courses, I don't know if you are yet, if you finished your physics already, but those also have you use that a lot. Well, they try, but. And then in terms of running, you click the arrow. So think about it like when you send, when you send an email, you know how it makes that noise, right? The arrow does the same thing for your code, it sends it to the Arduino. Obviously your Arduino needs to be connected to it via, USB, micro USB. I forgot about this. Okay, and if you hate yourself, don't worry, we all experience pain when we code. 9 times out of 10, you'll never get your code right on the first try. You just have to keep going, trust me. Like, it never works. One time in CS32, we had a design with Battleship game, and I got this one error every 10 times I ran the code, like by myself, like if I clicked it 10 times, every one time I would get a Stack Overflow error. And I had no idea where it was coming from. And I actually asked Brain, my GB Cody, to help me with it. And we analyzed it for like an hour. And then we found out that it was because I had a plus one somewhere that I should have had that was just like messing up the entire thing. And that was the most annoying experience I've ever had with this. So don't worry. That's a horror story. You could probably find it much faster than me. I'm not like a god at coding. I don't like love it, but it's cool. But you don't worry if you hate yourself. It's okay. It'll work out. Alright, then that leads us to Kara.
Alright, well, now that you guys are all excited for coding, I'm going to talk about how to code an Arduino. So we sort of know like what the physical board actually is. We know about some of the pins on it. We've heard about the IDE. And now I'm going to talk about like the actual substance and what you're going to be putting in there yourself. So starting off, I know we did a raise of hands before, and most of you have already taken CS31, so this is all going to be like a pretty basic review. We're just going to go over it really quickly. So first of all, we're going to start with data types. So to declare some kind of variable, the general form that you're going to use is the type first, then the identifier or like the name of the variable, and then the expression or like the value of what you want that variable to be. So starting off, we have integer, that was pretty basic. So we have int by n to square root of 2. Float, same thing as an integer, except decimal, so it's not an integer. Float pi, 3.145. Character is interesting because it is not a number, it is a character, as the name says. We tend to put those in the little apostrophes, so don't put them in the quotation marks, I think that causes a compilation error. But I don't think we're going to be using those very much. And string is like a character, except there are several of them, and you put them in between the quotation marks. So string hi is hello world. And finally, we have a Boolean, which can have two values, and that is true or false. So in this case, our Boolean is lecture over, we set it equal to false. Hopefully that should be good for you all. Okay, operators. This is where it gets a little bit more complex, but we'll start easy. Arithmetic operators, they basically just do math. These are like the four most basic ones. I think there might be like also like modules or something. It's also don't worry about that yet. We just have addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. I have a quick little quiz for you. If you read through these examples here, what is the value of D at the end of this line of code? Yes.
6.
Correct. It would be 6. Everybody kind of follow this code here? Yeah, thumbs up. It's all good. Okay. Next, we have the comparison operators, and those are going to compare two values and output a boolean. So those two values can either be like values, like 1 and 2, like I have in these examples, or they could also be like A and B in this case, variables that have a value assigned to them. So first, we have not equal to and equal. Please remember that equals is equal sign, not just 1 equal sign. If you put 1 equal sign, that's going to try to do the assignment, which is not what you want to do for comparison. So a couple examples here. We have my bool 1 is not equal to 2, so that would return a true. My bool would be assigned the value true. My bool 1 equals 2, that would be false because 1 is not equal to 2. My bool 1 is greater than 2, that would be false because 1 is not greater than 2. So on and so forth. My bool 1 is less than 2 would be true. 1 is greater than or equal to 1 is true because 1 is equal to 1, and 2 is less than or equal to 1 would be false because 2 is greater than 1. Yeah, crazy stuff. Okay, hopefully you all got that. I'll move on to Booleans. Booleans are probably going to be the most complicated because it's sort of a little bit different from like all this other stuff, which you've probably seen just in the basic math. So Boolean operators are actually going to compare two Booleans as opposed to two values, and it's going to output a Boolean. So the three main ones that we're going to be using are not, and or. Not is the exclamation point, and is the double ampersand, or is the double bar. So a couple of examples, we have not true, assign that to bool, that you can think of not as just like doing the opposite. So if I say not true, that's going to give it a false. If I say not false, that's going to give it a true. Next we have and. So if we have a true statement and a true statement, that's going to give us a true. But if we have a true statement and a false statement, that's going to give us a false, because they both need to be true in order to return a true. Or is different. If we have a true or false, that's going to return a true, because only one of them needs to be true. But if we have false and false, or false or false, that's going to return a false, because we're false or different. Okay, finally, a little bit slightly more complicated. So I kind of combined the comparison operator and a Boolean operator. I have my bool is equal to 1 is greater than 2, or 1 is greater than or equal to 1. Does anybody know what my bool is going to be? Yes, please.
Because the first one is false, the second one is true, and or is the one true.
Exactly. So if one of them is true, if with a or statement, then the whole thing is going to be evaluated as true. If those are both false, then it would be false. If those are both true, then it would still be true. Okay. Hopefully that all makes sense. Okay. Syntax. This one's also pretty easy. Nothing too crazy here. We have semicolons. Hopefully you've noticed by now we are putting semicolons at the end of every statement. So that's just kind of a convention. That's the way it works. So you're going to denote the end of the statement with a semicolon. So if I say this is my statement, end of the semicolon. That way the reader knows that's the end of your statement. In finance, we're going to denote a semicolon. If we call a function, we're also going to be ending back the semicolon. That is series ln. Don't worry about what that means yet. We'll get into it. Next, we have if, else if, and else statements. Usually, we call it if else statements, but I decided to add it also because it's also important. You're basically just going to be, well, what it does is it determines which lines of code are going to be executed by evaluating one or more conditions you put next to it. So you start out with if, you put in some condition there, let's say 1 is less than 2, that would be true. That's the case, then it would do that thing. That wasn't the case for some reason, and it would go to the next statement. In this case, over there, it would be else if condition 2, it would check the second condition. I missed a parentheses over there, but don't worry about it. Check another one over there. So then it would see if the condition 2 was true. If it was true, then it would do the other thing. If it's true, then it would go to some kind of else statement, which isn't there, so it would just do that. In this case, this is like a more concrete Arduino specific example where it's reading the analog pin or the analog pin variable, and it's seeing if that is equal to 1023. And if it says that that is true, the value of analog pin is also 1023, then it's going to digital write to the LED pin a signal of high, which would be the 5 volts. However, if analog pin was something like, let's say, 1022, therefore they're not equal, then it would go to the else statement, which says digital write LED low, so it would output a low signal to the LED pin. Okay, so far in all this review, like, everybody understands everything? Okay, I thought so.
Good.
Okay, so now we are getting more into actual Arduino specific stuff. I know Eli went over this one a little bit already, but I'll just go over it again. So we have, when you first open up a new sketch in the Arduino IDE, you're going to get something that looks like the thing on the top that says void setup, and then it has a little comment that says put your setup code here to run once, which is very accurate because the setup loop, or setup void function, only runs once. It runs at the very beginning of each build. And usually we use that just to kind of set up pins that we're going to be using throughout our loop code, which is the next thing that runs. So the void loop, it will run all of the instructions within the void loop repeatedly, which is why it says put your main code in here to repeatedly. The reason why we need a loop for that is because you don't want your code to just run once, then your Arduino turns off. It's not very productive. Usually you want to be like constantly monitoring something, which is why the loop is there. That's basically where you're going to put the bulk of your actual code into. So there's a good example right there. In the void setup, you see that you set the pin mode to the serial begin. We'll get into that later. But it's basically, those are like things you don't want it to be repeated. you to be doing. You only need to do it once, then you can go into the main code. The main code is when we start doing some interesting stuff like digital write to some of our pins, printing to our serial monitor, having our delays and things like that. Something you might also notice is that there is an int LED equals 13 above the void setup. That is also valid. You can also do that. You don't technically need to put it inside the void setup, but it's usually nice to, I guess, but it's not like illegal, basically. That's the reason why that example is there. Oh yeah, and also, if you're confused about anything, please check our Arduino documentation, like the root of all this stuff we get to.
Do you want to ask a question? Do any of you have any questions so far? Yes, no? Okay.
So, these are some of the most useful functions that you're going to be using with your Arduino. First things first, pin mode. This one's pretty easy. Usually, you're going to be using pin mode in order to say, I want to use this pin, and I want to set it to either be an input or an output. It has to be one or the other, by the way. Like, you have to make it input or output. So, in this case, I'm saying pin mode, I want pin 13 to set it to input, so that means it's going to reading some kind of signal. Pin mode of 12 is going to be an output, and pin mode of pin 11 is also going to be an output. So I would be able to output some kind of signal to those pins. And as we saw on the previous slide, usually we put these in setup. Okay, I will move to the right. Next, we're going to go to digital read. So digital read, it basically reads whatever pin that you put in there in the parentheses, and it will output either a high, which is a 1, or a low, which is a 0. So if I said pin mode 13 is an input, so that means I can read from pin 13, and then later on I say I want to set int i1 to whatever pin 13 is right now. So I would say int i1 equals digital read. Hopefully it's pretty intuitive so far. Next is going to be digital write. So it's also not too bad. It just writes out the value of either high or low to that pin. So because I said before that pin 12 is going to be an output, I can say digital write 12 high, and that's going to output a high signal from pin 12. Okay, it gets a little bit more complicated once you start getting into the analog pins. So if you recall, the analog pins are read-only, which is, there is an analog write function, but that has to do with pulse modulation, so don't worry about that. But analog read, you can only read from analog pins. And analog pins are going to have an A in front of them. So analog read will return you a value from 0 to 1023. Those are going to correspond to different voltage levels. So like 0 would be like 0 volts, 1023 is like the highest voltage that it can. In this case, I say int i2, I want it to read the pin a0. Everybody good so far? Yes, okay, great. I'll go to analog write.
Question.
Oh, there's a question, sorry.
Do we have a pin mode for analog read, or is it just for digital use?
Okay, sorry, could you repeat the question?
Do we need a pin mode for analog read commands? Like, we have to do a pin mode for digital read and digital writes, but do we have to do those for?
I believe you don't, because all of the analog pins are, like, automatically input only.
Okay.
Yeah. You can't output anything from them. Okay. So, analog write, however, is different. Analog write does not come from an analog pin. It comes from a pulse modulation pin. Those are different, so just remember that. Only compatible with pulse modulation pins. You cannot declare a, or you cannot ask a digital pin to analog write. So it's going to write out a value from 0 to 255 to the pin. Again, those numbers are going to correspond to some kind of voltage level. In this case, I say analog write 11, 125. And if you were to check on your Arduino Uno, it should, your 11 pin should have a little tilde next to it, which means it's a pulse width modulation pin. And in the case for these ones, you do have to declare them to be an output. Okay, and last but not least, delay. Delay is nice because sometimes we don't want our Arduino So delay time, we'll pause the code for a specified number of milliseconds. So if I say delay 1000, that's going to give it a 1 second delay. Again, if any of these things confuse you, there are more detailed explanations in the documentation. There's a lot of good stuff there.
And then also in terms of that question about declaring the analog read pin, I believe it's not necessary, but it's good practice to still declare it as an input, okay? Just for completion.
All right, so this is where we get into even more interesting things. So, first things first. Eli mentioned something about the serial monitor. So the serial monitor is a way for your computer to send messages, okay, period. So if you have a serial print function, if you declare it there and you put like some kind of string, in that case you have hello world, then once it gets to that line of code, it's going to print out your hello world to your serial monitor. Okay, that's like the basic overview. More important part is you have to say serial.begin with a baud rate at the in your setup. Kind of like pin mode, we use it to initialize to the serial monitor. The reason why we need to initialize it is because the serial monitor actually uses like a type of communication, which we're going to be learning more about later, but it is really important for you to say what the baud rate is. Just copy these so you can kind of understand what it does. Just make sure you have it or else your serial monitor is not going to work. And of course, serial print, pretty easy. Just put some string in there. You can even put a variable in there, and it's going to print out the value of that variable, kind of like how I have i_1 in that code example. It can be a string in quotations or a variable, and it will print it out the same way. You'll also see in my code example that there is a serial print ln. Ln just basically means it's a line, so it's going to have like an enter afterwards. Last but not least, this is kind of unrelated but still important, so I wanted to include it on the slide, is hashtag define. So hashtag define, it's just basically a global constant, creates a global constant that you can use throughout your program. And this is usually what we use to have nice pin names. So you can see at the top here, I say pin 1 is 13, pin 2 is 80. So that means like I'm going to call pin 13 pin 1, and I'm going to call pin 80. And please make sure to not put a semicolon after your define statements, or else it won't work.
What's the difference between using define to create like a global constant versus just writing a constant?
I think functionally there's basically no difference. Define just looks nice, I guess. You can use whichever you prefer. Any questions about the serial monitor or define? Alright, so this is some example code you can actually load up yourself if you want to install the Arduino IDE sooner. So this is the top left is the way you get to it. Go to examples, basics, and link. And this is all the code that they have. Pretty easy. So let's just like kind of walk through what's happening here. So in void setup, we have pin mode, LED built in, and that's set to an output. And then in our loop, we have LED built in, we set it to high, then we delay it for a second, and then we set LED built in to low, and then we delay it for a second again. Okay, so I have a couple of questions for you guys. Why must we declare LED built in pin to be an output?
Function, you're writing to it, so it's declared as an output. Or you like send stuff to it.
Exactly, that's pretty much it. Because it's a digital pin, it could either function as an input or as an output. So we have to declare it as an output so that your Arduino knows that it can read it and not write to it. So those are two very different functions. Okay. Why must there be a delay after we turn it on and off? Why can't I just put digital write LED built in high and then digital write LED built in low? What are those delays for?
You'd be essentially turning on and turning off your LED.
Yeah. So how do you think like it would look like if I took out those blades?
Maybe it would stop them, maybe it just wouldn't work, I don't know.
Yeah, it would probably either be completely on or just completely off, just because it would be switching so fast. Yeah, you're right. Okay, any questions about Arduino coding in general? Any of the functions that I went over?
Yeah, with the serial begin off thing, is it necessary for us to include it like every single time you try to create a bunch of different
stuff? Yes, you have to put it in setup every time. Because each, you know, each document, whenever you have one of these documents, like this one is called Link, for example, like that's its own thing. When you're uploading it to your Arduino, it's only going to be reading that. So it's not like your Arduino is going to have some kind of baud rate already like set in its head. He doesn't know. You have to declare it each time.
Basically, what happens when you upload the code is it wipes the Arduino first and then starts fresh and puts this on it. So yeah, you need to, if you're using this here monitor, you need to declare it every time. And baud rate for now is just 9600, but there's plenty of applications where you can use different baud rates. We actually have a project using the HC05 that's in like Spring. But that's a project that deals with a baud rate of 115,200. And that's something that you need to learn eventually.
We're gonna have a lecture, I think, later this quarter on like communication protocols, which is where that baud rate comes from, and then it will probably make a little bit more sense then to get to that. Yes.
Why are we not defining what LED built in is?
That's a really good question. So LED built-in is actually just kind of like the name implies, a built-in pin within your Arduino Uno. So kind of like how, like if you kind of think about it, if you have like 11, like, you know, pin 11 is, you know, 11, you know, it's pin 11. It's kind of the same idea, where LED built-in is sort of just this name that Arduino recognizes as being one of the components within the board.
So we can either use keyboard LED built in to use like the built-in LED,
right.
Or like an integer from one through four, like how many different pins it has.
Well, LED built in, it only connects to the LED on the board, so it's not like a pin that you can access very easily. If you want like a general import output pins, that's going to be one of the numbers that's on your board. Luckily, the Arduino Uno is like pretty easy to read. You can have to just like take it out and look at it, and you'll be able to see like, which ones are which. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Serial to begin. That's like a serial. So in this case, when we're doing, since we're just trying to turn the LED on and off, like I don't see a serial begin.
Right. Yeah, so if you're not using the serial monitor, if you're not having any like serial.print statements, then you don't need to initialize the serial monitor. I mean, you still can if you want to. It's not going to hurt or anything. But that's the reason why it's not in this particular piece of code.
What happens if you try to read input from the built-in LED?
It would probably just output some kind of nonsense value.
Oh.
Yeah, either or low.
Yeah.
Probably more likely low, but I mean, because it's not like connected to anything, it's kind of the same idea where it's just like a floating number.
Uh-huh.
So really, it's kind of like undefined behavior. It will just output whatever.
If you guys like want a fun brain teaser with your Arduino, where they just like connect the wire to one of the analog pins, stick it in the air, and like run like your serial monitor, and you'll just see like spits out like jargon, like random values that, and it's just because it's like reading everything, and like the micro, like electrical signals in the air, but like it doesn't really matter. That's also like a big source of error with some of your readings. We'll get into that like your projects, but some of your readings like jump, you know, all of a sudden you have like your output zero, and all of a sudden jumps, and it goes back to zero. Something that happens, it's something you have to count.
So not only
that's the career level.
Yeah, pretty much.
All
right. Okay. Any last questions?
No? Yes? Maybe?
We also have those applicants.
Yeah.
Okay. This is actually kind of premature. I think workshop 2 is not until within 2 weeks. Kind of moved it. But this is something to look forward to. If you've never used an Arduino before and you would like to get some experience before we start on our next project, which is the iPoduino, you should definitely come to our workshops. More information on that later.
Right.
Everybody.
Thank you for coming, guys. Yeah.
You guys still need the codes right here. Otherwise, we'll see you next week. Same place, same time, same day.
Stop the recording.